They shall bring out the bones of the king of Judah and the bones of his princes, mm-hmm. and the bones of the priests and the bones of the prophets, uh-huh. and the bones of the inhabitants of Jerusalem out of their grave.
So now what Jeremiah is prophesying about is we're going to go into a dead state. All of Israel was prophesied to completely forget the laws, statutes, and commandments of the Most High God. All right, so therefore, we fall into that dead state. All right, but it's going to come upon time. They're going to bring these bones out, all right, to be seen before men. Come on.
Verse 2, and they shall spread them before the sun and the moon, mm-hmm. and all the host of heaven, whom they have loved and whom they have served, mm-hmm. and after whom they have walked, and whom they have sought, and whom they have worshipped. They shall not be gathered, nor be buried. They shall be for dung upon the face of the earth. And death shall be chosen rather than life by all the residue of them that remain of this evil family.
So now, what we read now is about how Israel profaned the Lord's name. We did not hold true to these laws, statutes, and commandments. And what we started doing in the wilderness is we started serving and worshiping other gods, like the Egyptian gods in particular. All right? Just like fast forward to today, we do the same exact thing, worshiping other gods and pitting those things above the Most High. So God said, because of that, he's going to spread out our thing on bones before the sun and the moon and all their enemies whom we worship. Think about it. We worship the moon now. That's a part of Islam, is it not? Islam has the moon and a little star attached to them. We serve a daggone rock. Some of our people is involved in that thing. These are things that God created. They themselves are not God. But Israel, who God chose to be his people, started bowing down and worshiping these idols. So therefore, God said, I'm going to spread your bones among the stars, all right, whom you worship, all right? And you will not allow our bones and stuff to be buried, meaning you will be spiritually dead upon the earth. And those gods that you worship, let's see if they're going to gather your bones together and pitch you back. That's what God was doing. So he's making mockery of us right now. Anybody understand that? Mm-hmm. Read verse 3 again.
Verse 3. And death shall be chosen rather than life by all the residue of them that remain of this evil family.
So it's going to be a judgment that happened to the nation of Israel, that the people that is going to be alive, they're going to rather choose death, because that's going to be so much anguish and pain that they're going to be in. They're going to rather choose to be put to death. This is the prophecy of Deuteronomy 28. Read.
Which remain in all the places where I have driven them, saith the Lord of hosts.
Meaning we were scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. So no matter where you was at, these curses will fall you. Come on.
Moreover, thou shalt say unto them, thus said the Lord, shall they fall and not arise?
So now, he's telling Jeremiah, you won't say unto these backsliding people, shall they fall and they not rise? Come on.
Shall he turn away and not return?
Mm-hmm.
Why then is this people of Jerusalem slidden back by a perpetual backsliding?
Wow, they're constantly backsliding. They're not seeing all the hell and trouble that they went in, but they constantly keep going back to the same thing. This shows you how hard-headed we are as a people. We'll see all the miracles before our eyes, and we'll still, for some reason, turn back. Come on.
They hold fast deceit. They refuse to return.
They hold fast deceit and refuse to return. I'll give you a story. I'm always talking about the Bible at certain times, about two, whenever I get it, with certain individuals. And you will go to the scriptures and prove things out of the Bible. But the people that I talk to will always somehow manage to turn what you prove to them in the Bible into their own vain thoughts. And all you simply ask is, where is that in the Bible? But my brother, it's about context. I know it's about context. The Bible explains itself, though. Why are you always twisting it to make it sound like how you want it to sound? God hates these people. No, see, God hates the act of the people. Hey, I'm not making this stuff up. I'm telling you, people always find a way to suit Christianity, Islam, and all these other stupid false religions. This is why God says, verse 5 again.
Verse 5. Why then is this people of Jerusalem smitten back by a perpetual backsliding? They hold fast deceit.
So he asked the question, why do they go backwards? And then he answers, because they hold fast deceit. They love lies. They hate the truth. Read.
They refuse to return.
They refuse to keep his commandments. Come on.
I hearkened and heard, but they speak not aright. No man repented him of his wickedness.
None of them say, you know what, but what you show me out of the Bible is right. Let me stop doing that. They refuse to do it. Because why? Pride. Pride will keep you from then going moving forward in this truth. Somebody take this thing. You got to fix this about yourself. No, that ain't me. No, that's not me. I don't see that in myself. I don't know what you're talking about. Brother, sister, it's there. We see it. Oh, y'all making stuff up. Okay.
You picking on me.
You picking on me. It's always on me. It's all about me, me, me. Listen, maybe the Lord is trying to get you to become a better person. Did you think about that? Before you feel attacked or get on the defense? That addition lets you know you do have an issue. You should be able to take stock in that thing. Because if it wasn't true, most people like something, whatever. You know, they're home and say, oh, okay, you see that? Cool. All right, and keep on pushing. They may go home and they ain't gonna think about it for a second, and then be like, you know, maybe I do need to, they ain't gonna check on that. But if they truly don't have that, the person that may have made that assumption about them will come back and say, eventually, you know, I think I was wrong about that. Just let it go. It's water off a damn duck's back. But for when you get on the fence, that lets you know, yeah, that person hit the nail on the head. Read.
Saying, what have I done? Everyone turned to his course as the horse rushes into the battle.
They're so hard-headed that they go full throttle into their folly. Just like a horse. Read.
Yea, the star and the heaven knoweth her appointed time.
These are birds, come on. Meaning they know their appointed time.
And the turtle and the crane and the swallow observe the time of their coming.
Uh-huh.
But my people,
but Israel,
know not the judgment of the Lord.
God says they do not understand judgment. You got animals, storks and all that stuff is going into the angle, fowls of the air. They know when their death is approaching. They come to the angle glimpse with that thing. And if whatever happens, I'll deal with them. They got enough common sense about it to know, let me get my spirit right. You know what I'm saying? If that's the case. But what he's saying is, these are dumb animals. But even they got enough common sense to understand when they own their deathbed. You don't see animals that's getting hunted turn to the person that's hunting them. They're running. They're trying to save their life. But Israel turned to the Father. The devil's out hunting you, and you just give him a free platform to walk on in. You open the door and say, come on, have a seat with me. That's what you do. That's crazy. That's a form of backsliding. Read.
Verse 8. How do ye say we are wise?
How can we say that we are a wise nation of people?
And the law of the Lord is with us.
And God is dealing with us.
Lo, certainly in vain made he it.
Certainly in vain made he it what?
The pen of the scribe is in vain.
The pen of the scribe which wrote these things. He said those things are in vain. You don't know what you're talking about. God ain't dealing with us. When you got all these dang old sinners around here and nobody ain't saying that, nobody ain't calling up nothing, but yet we out here worshiping idols and all this stuff, and we try to say, oh, because we just Israel, God is with us. Mm-mm. Read.
The wise men are ashamed.
The wise men are ashamed. Come on.
They are dismayed and taken.
They are dismayed and taken. This wise men, for example, we had Aaron amongst us when we came out of Egypt, right? Aaron was considered to be one of the wise men. But Aaron became a part of the folly. Because why? He was overwhelmed by all the people forcing him to create a golden calf.
He was weak.
He was weak. So you have many of the wise men today that are ashamed at what Israel have become. Some of them, they know that they can't really do nothing because it's just them. Why? Because you got a multitude of wickedness around you and see that nobody is with you. So therefore, you kind of just bow out because you don't want to get attacked. But you know deep down inside, listen, ain't nothing I can do, Lord. You praying on the Lord, to the Lord on their behalf, but it's like they ain't trying to receive that. So the wise man is astonished. He's ashamed by that thing. Like, I can't believe this, Lord. But then he himself also finds himself going down the same path too, by falling along just to get along. Read.
Lo, they have rejected the word of the Lord.
They have rejected the words of God. Come on.
And what wisdom is in them?
And the wisdom is not in them. What is the wisdom? Give me Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 5. What is wisdom? He said, because wisdom is not in them. I want you to read Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 5 through 6.
The book of Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 5.
Come on.
Behold, I have taught you statute and judgment.
God gave these laws to Moses to teach it to the children of Israel. He has taught us statutes and commandments. Come on.
Even as the Lord my God commanded me.
Read.
That ye should do so in the land where you go to possess it.
When it was getting to the promised land, he was telling you, you got to observe and keep these commandments before you get to the promised land. Read.
Keep therefore and do them.
You got to keep them and do them. Read.
For this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations.
This is your wisdom and understanding in the sight of the nations. Therefore, when the nations see us keeping these commandments, they understand that we are a wise and understanding people. But when you're not keeping the laws of God, they look at you or they look at us as niggas and spicks. Y'all stupid. This is why they run through our neighborhoods in buses in Harlem and these other real bad, what they call urban areas, and they make fun of us. They drive through there and they have tour buses that come through the city and look at the graffiti on the buildings, how they run down, niggas on the block, talking about this is my block, G4 for life, ripping, black and red. That's foolishness. They're saying these niggas here is stupid. But when they see us gathering together like how we doing right now, wearing our fringes, conducting ourselves like royalty, they take stock in that thing and say, wait a minute, that's a wise and understanding people right there. They know who they are. This is why Moses said that again, verse 6.
Verse 6, keep therefore and do them.
When you keep the laws of God and do this, read.
For this is your wisdom and your understanding and the sight of the nation.
It shows the nation that you have wisdom and understanding as to who you are. Understand that thing. Go back to Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 9 again. The book of Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 9. All right? We're dealing with Jesus Christ is the bomb. All right? Our Christ is the bomb.
Well, Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 9.
Come on.
The wise men are ashamed. They are dismayed and taken.
So now it says the wise men are ashamed. Meaning they know the laws. They can teach the law. They try to warn the people. But they become dismayed at how hard-headed we are. And they themselves become taken. Read.
Lo, they have rejected the word of the Lord.
The word lo means, listen, Israel have rejected the words of God. Read.
And what wisdom is in them?
And what wisdom is in them? Because it's certainly not the wisdom of God. Come on.
Therefore, will I give their wives unto others, and their fields to them that shall inherit them? For every one, from the least even to the greatest, is given to covetousness.
Uh-oh, so now we see what the problem is. Every last one of us, to the dang of mightiest of men, unto the base of men, were all given unto covetousness. That covetousness goes into a lot of things. All right, it's a broad statement. Meaning, it can be they covet the neighbor's wife. They covet the neighbor's husband. They covet the neighbor's clothes, the house. They covet money. They covet many different things. They covet idolatry, other gods. They want to be like the nation that was around about them. That covetousness goes into a pool of things. So he said, each and every last one of them was given unto covetousness. All right? He says, and I will give their wives unto what? The other nations and their fields. This is give me Deuteronomy 28 and verse 30. Deuteronomy 28 and verse 30. This is the prophecy that Jeremiah is making reference to. Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 30.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 30.
This is what Jeremiah was making reference of.
Thou shalt be brought a wife.
Meaning the man should get a wife. Come on.
And another man shall lie with her.
Oh, that's the problem. And another man shall lie with her. But God is saying in Jeremiah, I will give the wives to others. Why did God give our women to other people? Because what? We was not keeping the commandments. Read.
Thou shalt build a house, and thou shalt not dwell therein.
We built the White House, and we did not live in
democracy and freedom. But behind the proud history of the White House are the black hands of hundreds of slaves.
It was the slaves that did a lot of the building of the White House. They also worked there, did the service jobs, where the people that would tend the horses or clean the dishes, prepare the meals.
Hey, everyone.
Thou shalt plant a vineyard.
We should plant a vineyard. We should have our crops and flocks, things that we supposed to have ownership of, agree?
And shall not gather the grapes thereof.
But guess what? We would not reap the benefits of those things. All right? Read.
Thy ox shall be slain before thine eyes.
Your ox shall be slain before your eyes.
And thou shalt not eat thereof. Thine ass shall be violently taken away from before thy face.
Mm-hmm.
And shall not be restored to thee.
He said, your ass shall be taken away from you and shall not be restored unto you. You may think, well, we ain't never owned no animals. When we came out of slavery, what did they promise to us? 40 acres and a what? What's another word for mule?
Ass.
Donkey. So this is what he's talking about here. Read that again. Verse 31.
Verse 31. Thy ox shall be slain before thy eyes.
So your ox is going to be slain before your eyes. Come on.
And thou shalt not eat thereof.
And then you just do not eat thereof. Come on. The ox here represents the Native American Indians. This case is why it gets simple. They was over here first. They had oxen and all that stuff. They destroyed the dango cattle here and made dango cowboy boots and all this other stuff. Read.
Thy ass shall be violently taken away from before thy face.
Now we use the ass to plow our fields. We would stick some kind of little vice on the back of it, where they had like a little pin that go down into the ground, and they would hold that thing, and that ass would plow the ground.
To plow
it with. Therefore, we never got that. So this all goes into that. Understand this thing. Go back to Jeremiah chapter 8. I'm going to show y'all the prophecy and what Jeremiah was talking about. The days that Moses was prophesying to the children of Israel in the wilderness, it was constantly being fulfilled all throughout the scriptures and even unto this day.
Book of Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 10.
Come on.
Therefore will I give their wives unto others.
So this is fulfilled in Deuteronomy 28.
And their fields to them that shall inherit them.
The same thing.
For everyone from the least even unto the greatest is given to covetousness. Mm-hmm. From the prophet even unto the priest, everyone dealeth falsely.
So even the prophet and the priest became wicked. Come on.
For they have healed the hurt of the daughter of my people slightly.
They have healed the hurt of the daughter of my people slightly. Saying what?
Saying peace, peace, when there is no peace.
Now, I know this may seem like it's angle confusing, but I'm going to help you all understand it. Give me Matthew chapter 2 and verse 6. Let's deal with the my people. All right? Let's deal with that real quick.
The book says Matthew chapter 2 and verse 6.
Come on.
And though Bethlehem and the land of Judah are not the least among princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor.
Out of Judah shall come a governor.
That shall rule my people Israel.
That shall rule who?
My people Israel.
So God's people is who? The Israelites. Understand that. Go back to Jeremiah chapter 8. And verse 11 again.
The book Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 11. For they have healed the hurt of the daughter of my people slightly, saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace.
So now, when it says he have healed the hurt of my people slightly, I want you to highlight, and this is going to be the main focal point of this chapter. This is why the title of class is called Christ is the bomb. So this is the point of beginning to understand this chapter. The priests, all right, and the prophets, they dealt falsely amongst the people. And then he goes further by explaining, saying that they have healed the hurt of my people slightly by saying what? Peace. Shalom. Shalom. That's what the word peace means. Shalom, brother, everything will be all right. Listen, hey, I'm down and out. How come Israel ain't doing all right? Hey, peace unto you, brother. Everything gonna be all right. Don't worry about it. Just keep sowing your arms. Keep giving your tithes and offering. He was healing the hurt of the people slightly by giving them false pretense. That's the same thing that you read about or that you see right now going on in the Christian church. They healed the hurt of Israel slightly. The people coming in sick, lame, all kind of diseases. All kind of dang old trials and tribulation, and the dang old pastors have nothing biblical to give them to sustain it and make their life better. He tell them, come as you are, believe as you be. How's that healing them? You tell them, God don't care about you keeping no commandments. All you got to do is have faith in Christ. That's healing the hurt of the people slightly. Telling them, peace, peace, when there's no peace. We got war and rumors of war going on around us right now. But the day gonna pass us, tell them, hey, everything's gonna be all right. Just believe in Christ Jesus, the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. You lead, you day will heal the hurt of the people slightly. You're not doing them a service. You're doing them a disservice. That's what he's saying here. Everybody understand that? Read.
Verse 12. Were they ashamed when they had committed abomination?
That's the question. Were they ashamed?
Nay.
No, they was not ashamed. That's what the word nay means. No.
They were not at all ashamed.
Uh-huh.
Neither could they blush.
They wasn't even they were slightly ashamed by that thing. Really?
Therefore, shall they fall among them that fall? In the time of their visitation, they shall be cast down, saith the Lord.
These pastors that do not teach the word of God properly before that time comes, they too shall be cast down. They might have a greater punishment. Read.
I will surely consume them, saith the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
There shall be no grapes on the vine,
no
figs on the fig tree.
Read.
And the leaf shall fade. And the things that I have given them shall pass away from them.
So that great green pasture that we was talking about a couple of days ago in Psalms 23. He said, listen, that land is going to be taken away from you. When we had it under the dang old time of David, we would have had it for 40 years. Solomon, 40 years. We never kept it for eternity. We'll get it fall back into sin. You'll get it, backslide again. You'll get it, God said, no, that's it. That's it. Y'all ain't gonna never see this again. He's gonna turn all the green passes into dangled leaves that fade and just start discoloring. Because why we didn't appreciate it? This is why we talked about the new moon. Coming to the Lord's house with what? Joyfulness and gladness of heart. Praising his name, thanking him for the many grace and mercy that he bestowed upon us. But oh no, we just can't seem to get right. Really?
Why do we sit still? Assemble yourself and let us enter into the defense city and let us be solid there. For the Lord our God had put us to solid and given us water of gall to drink because we have sinned against the Lord.
So they say, listen, why are we sitting here? Let's just assemble ourselves together and enter into the defense city. And let us be silent there. Meaning, let us just go and die there. That's where the word silent goes into. Let us just go and die there. Because God evidently has sent us today to be put today on death. Gall equates today on poison. All right? When you read it, it said, God have given us, have put us to silence. Meaning, have cast us today to be put to death. And have given us water of gall. Gall is poison. That's what that is. All right? To drink. Because, why? We've sinned. So once Israel figured out the reason why they went through these things, it was already too late. Now, people dying. Y'all could have prevented this. So instead of saying, you know, let's repent, even on our dying bed, no, let's just go ahead and just die here, man, and don't even acknowledge God. All right, read.
We look for peace.
We look for peace.
But no good came.
But no good came. Come on.
And for a time of health, and behold, trouble.
Uh-oh, he said, but instead of time of health, what we got instead? Trouble. Highlight that there. All right. Verse 15. Highlight that. And verse 11. Highlight that. It's going to make the Dagon class be able to make you be able to understand the class. All right. Read.
The snorting of his horse was heard from Dan.
Uh-huh.
The whole land trembled at the sound of the neighing of his strong one.
So now, Dan was a part of the 12 tribes. He was our brother. But Dan turned aside and became our enemy. Our own brother turned against us. This is why you don't read about him in the list of the gates. You don't read about Dan. Because Dan became a traitor. Give me Genesis chapter 49, verse 16. Genesis chapter 49, verse 16.
The book Genesis chapter 49, and verse 16. Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribe of Israel.
Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel.
Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path that biteth the horse's heel.
An adder is a snake. All right, come on.
So that his rider shall fall backward.
Therefore, that his rider shall fall backward. So he's showing you the characteristics of how Dan would be. Dan became a serpent, a deceiver, a backbiter, causing his brothers and sisters to stumble backwards. So again, the Bible explains itself. All right, that's all I want from that. So let's go back. Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 16 one more time.
But Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 16.
So we're dealing with the house of Israel being wicked and becoming unrecognizable before the Lord. Come on.
The snorting of his horses was heard from Dan.
So now, when we talk about the snorting of the horses, now we got the precept to prove where we got this from. Y'all see that? Read.
The whole land trembled at the sound of the neighing of his strong one.
The whole land, meaning all 12 tribes, trembled at this day because they never realized that he would do that. So his brothers got scared of him. Read.
For they are come and have devoured the land and all that is in it.
This is why it's so important for us to understand that you cannot have traitors among us. This is why we do the search. This is why we make rules up where you cannot bring randoms to the high holy days. We don't know those spirits. We don't know what they're capable of. This Christ warned us in the last days, be circumspect of your own selves, because there will be traitors among yourselves. We read it and put it in the scriptures. Come on.
The city and those that dwell therein. For behold, I will send serpent cockatrices among you, which will not be charmed, and they shall bite you, saith the Lord.
Now, these dang old cockatrices are that came among us, meaning these serpents, these snakes. These are things going into people that is going to come with smooth words to try to gain off our affliction. The same thing going on today. They'll come into our neighborhood and tell you, oh, we got urban project set up for y'all communities. Come here and we'll get you some houses. You go there and get the house, go get assistance for housing. Then they give you stupid rules like, okay, well, you got a baby daddy? Okay, well, listen, he can't be in the house. That's a serpent. That's a deceiver. You're not here to help. You're here to further the affliction. They'll tell you, oh, you having a problem with your bringing a child into the world? Okay, we'll give you WIC, or we'll give you this, that, and the third. But the black man can't be in the house. Or they'll tell you, well, you know what? Oh, you and the baby daddy ain't getting along. You don't want to have the baby. Well, we'll fund you to have an abortion. Therefore, we'll pit Planned Parenthood inside the community. These are all crafty devices to destroy our people. Therefore, read that again. Verse 17.
Verse 17. For behold, I will send serpents.
Serpents is snakes. These people that come among us are snakes. Read.
Cockatrices.
Uh-huh.
Among you.
Among us. It's going to be your own people. Read.
Which will not be charmed.
You cannot charm them. You cannot say, now listen, brother, don't do that. Don't be like that, man. Hey, we want this work together. He going to laugh in your face like, yeah, man, you're right. But then as soon as he leave you, hey, I'm going to tell you all the game plan. They got a room right here. They got this one here working the door. This got this many people right here. They got this kind of money. They telling all the inside scoop. Traitors. Yep.
And they shall bite you, said the Lord.
And they will bite you. They will cause harm and affliction on you. Come on.
When I will comfort myself against sorrow, my heart is faint in me.
God is troubled when he sees this thing. He's bothered by that thing. Come on.
Behold, the voice of the cry of the daughter of my people because of them that dwell in a far country.
That's going into us today. Not dwelling in our land close to Jerusalem. We fall from our home. Read.
Is not the Lord in Zion?
Is not the Lord in Zion?
Is not her king in her?
Is not her king in her? What is this talking about? Read 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Is not the Lord in Zion? Is not her king in her? What is that talking about? 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16.
The book 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16.
Read down to 17.
Know ye not that ye are the temple of God.
Understand that you all are the temple of God. Every last one of us is the temple of God. Read.
And that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you.
And the what?
The Spirit of God dwelleth in you.
And the Spirit of God wants to dwell in you. So when we read in Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 19, where it says, is not the Lord in Zion? Meaning, is not the Lord among us? Is not his Spirit will be dwelling within us? Read.
If any man defile the temple of God.
Meaning if you defile yourself for what? The idolatry? The dangle fake gods that we just read about in Jeremiah? That we dangle fell subject to? When we begin to defile ourselves by these other gods and become backsliders, going against the laws of God, we defile ourselves. Therefore, the law said, I cannot dwell in a dangle unclean temple. So when you defile yourself with idolatry, God is not among us. He's not dealing with us. Read.
Him shall God destroy.
God said, therefore, when I'm not among you, I got to destroy you. Jump to verse 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. We left the thought about Christ is the bone.
The book 2 Corinthians, chapter 13 and verse 5.
Uh-huh.
Examine yourselves.
Read.
Whether ye be in the faith.
Whether the truth or the spirit is within us.
Prove your own self.
Prove our own self by the laws of God.
Know ye not your own self.
And make sure you do a thorough examination of self.
How that Jesus Christ is in you. Except he be reprobate.
Christ is in us, except we're not operating in a reprobate mind. If we're not operating in a reprobate mind, Christ is dealing with us. But if we operate in a reprobate mind, Christ is not in you. He's not in us. This is why we always got to do a self-examination of ourselves. Constantly. Never get to the point where you think you got it all together. Always think to yourself, you know, it's a possibility I got some kind of demon still lurking around me. And hopefully that'll keep you humble. Because if you think you ain't gonna rise to the occasion, that's when you always fall. That's why you always fall. That's why I tell you, I'm Black Nigga Tyrone. I don't know nothing. Go back to Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 19 again.
Book Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 19. Behold, the voice of the cry of the daughter of my people because of them that dwell in a far country.
He said, because behold, the voice of the cry of the daughters of my people because they dwell in a far country. So God is hearing Israel cry unto him now. We're hurting. We're in pain. We're being afflicted right now, is what you're reading right now in Jeremiah chapter 8. We're being afflicted. Come on.
Is not the Lord in Zion?
Is not the Lord among us?
Is not her king in her? Why have thou provoked me to anger with their graven images?
There we go. Again, we proving what we're saying. This is going into the fact that Israel fell into idolatry. We started worshiping other gods, and it's still going on to this day. We can't seem to separate ourselves from Caesar, man. Yeah. We think, oh, well, if we take him out of the church, if we take his image off the wall, off the stained glass, that is proof that we're not in idolatry. If you're still learning the doctrine of Christianity, you're still operating in idolatry. That's a form of idolatry. That's not the pure doctrine. Regardless if you take Caesar going off the wall. If you're still going to the Christian church, learning on Sunday, deal the way that they deal, telling the lost gods that are, you're still in idolatry. You have not repented. You are not healed. You're still stricken and sick. Read.
And with strange vanity.
And with strange vanity. I mean, it was strange idols. These things are nothing. Read.
The harvest is past. The summer is ended, and we are not saved.
Give me Matthew chapter 25, verse 10. The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not, what?
Saved.
So we ain't saved. So what is Christian pastors getting us at?
The book of Matthew, chapter 25 and verse 10.
Come on.
And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came.
When they went to buy, the bridegroom came. The summer has passed, all right, and it's ended. The harvest is past, and the summer is ended. Read.
And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage.
But those that was ready and had themselves together, they went into the dang old wedding. Read down to verse 11.
And the door was shut.
And the doors was shut. Come on.
Afterward came also the other virgins.
Oh, so now the harvest time is over. Christ now came and collected and gathered his saints. Now, it says, the day of summer is ended. Read.
Saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said,
what?
Verily I say unto you, I know you not.
I don't know you. So now let's go back to Jeremiah chapter 8 one more time. And remember the parable that we just read. 8 and verse 20.
The book of Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 20. The harvest is past.
The harvest goes here or is equating to when Christ comes and says, listen, hey, you are an Israelite. Repent and keep the commandments. Those that accept what Christ said, hearken unto his word, started repenting and keeping these commandments, God reaped them. They went into the way. Come on.
The summer is ended.
But now the summer is ended. It's now from dang on harvest time, where it's winter, when you do all your gathering. Now it's dang on summertime, and we still outside, and ain't nobody came and reap us yet. We still out here sweating and being afflicted. That's the ones that did not listen when Christ said, repent. Therefore, they did not come in with the harvest. Free.
And we are not saved.
And we are left outside. Christ said in Matthew what? 25:11. Listen, I don't know you. So that's the one that he's talking about is not saved. Understand? Y'all see that? Makes sense. Let's make it make sense. Read on.
For the hurt of the daughter of my people, am I hurt?
He said, for the hurt of the daughter of my people, I too am hurt. So when God looked at that thing, that hurts him. He don't want to see any of his people perish. But when you don't take heed, he has to punish you. Read.
I am black.
Meaning now I'm in mourning now. Come on.
Astonishment had taken hold on me.
So this black here literally means mourning. All right? And if you don't believe me, go get the Strong Concordance. Look it up, because I'm not doing the work for you. I done did it, and I proved it. I can tell you it's in it. That's what that black means. It means mourning right here. Now, when we read the I am black in Revelation 14, listen, that means literally, he's the color black. You see what I'm saying? Lamentation 4 and verse 8, when you say the vicious, that's how their faces are black. That means black. This here ain't talking about black faces. This here is talking about mourning. Understand that. Read.
Is there no balm in Gilead?
Uh-oh, so now we get to the point now. He said, my people are hurt, therefore I hurt. And I mourn for my people because I'm astonished that they have not taken hold of me. So now he ends off the daggone chapter by saying what? Is there what?
No balm in Gilead.
Is there no balm in Gilead? Gilead is the place where this story took place. He said, is there no balm in Gilead? Balm is healing ointment. Look that up real quick. Type in balm. Definition of balm. I want you to read that again.
Is there no balm in Gilead?
If there's no balm in Gilead?
Is there no physician there?
He said, now, is there no physician there? Is there nobody there to heal them? The balm is what you use as an ointment to put on a scar, a bruise. He said, is there no healing ointment in Gilead? Is there no physician there to teach them the word of God, to heal them, to stop the hurt? So he's asking them, why isn't there no balm in Gilead?
Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered?
Why then is not the health of the daughters of my people recovered? In other words, why are they not healed? So this here, brothers and sisters, is the definition of balm. Because I know somebody might have been simple and say, oh, Christ is the balm. Yeah, y'all think you're talking about, oh, no, we ain't talking about that kind of balm. We're talking about this right here. Read that. Oh, open it back up again so you can see it. There you go. Read that.
Number one, a fragrant ointment.
It's a fragrant ointment.
A preparation used to heal or soothe the skin.
The purpose of a balm is used to heal or soothe the skin. Come on.
It's skin balm for use after shaving.
Whenever you shave, you get the itchy dang on things on your face, you need the ointment. Which you brothers if will be shaving anyway. But when we use the shave, I understand why you need that ointment.
Number two. a tree which yield a fragrant residence, substance, especially when used in medicine.
So now when we read Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 22 again, it says, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician? Who uses this medicine? Physicians, doctors. Read.
Number three, a bitchy herb of the mint family with leaves smelling and tasting of lemon.
So now, go back to Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 22 one more time.
But Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 22. Is there no balm in Gilead?
Is there no healing ointment, medicine for the people to soothe them? Come on.
Is there no physician there?
Is there no prophet there that can prophesy the word of God and not fall subject to the dang of people around them? Come on.
Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered?
The reason why the health of the daughters of God's people not recovered is because none of these things exist at that time. You did not have righteous men to teach the word of God properly, and there was not no ointment, meaning the word of God that was supposed to be used to heal the people, they was abusing it too. Because go back up to verse 11 in that chapter. This is why I told you how to highlight certain verses.
But Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 11.
Come on.
For they have healed the hurt of the daughter of my people slightly.
Wait a minute. Who is the they? The false prophets. They healed the hurt of God's people, who were the Israelites, slightly. They ain't giving the true healing, the true balm. They give them that fake generic brand of balm. That's what they give. They give them that generic brand. Ain't the real thing, but it's something close to it, just to kind of keep you coming. Ain't enough to really cure it. It's just kind of enough to just soothe it over for the time being. That's what it was doing. And that's what these Christian churches do. Give us that fake imitation generic brand of the gospel and not healing God's people truly. Because why? There's no physician in this land. There's no true medicine that they can administer to the people to heal them. So therefore, the people are not recovering their health. They're not being restored like how it was from the beginning. Give me that go, 2 Chronicles 7 and verse 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. So now let's break this down.
The book 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14.
Mm-hmm.
If my people, which are called by my name,
mm-hmm,
shall humble themselves.
If they should do what?
Shall humble themselves.
So now, the people that is hurting, that's being afflicted, if you want true healing, God is giving you the antidote right here. He's telling you, you are my people that are called by my name, Israel. If we should only do what? Humble ourselves. Read.
And pray.
Then secondly, we have to begin to pray unto the Father. Face our land and pray toward the east. Read.
And seek my face.
How do we seek the face of God? By reading this Bible. You're not going to go into the high mountain, searching high and low all over the planet, looking to see the face of God. God, is you there in this mountain? Oh, no, you're not there. Okay. I'm going to go hike for another 7 years in another mountain and see if your face is there. No. God's face is the Bible. Read.
And turn from their wicked ways.
So now, instead of being backsliders, we have to repent. That's what it means by return from your wicked ways. Meaning repent of the evil that we was doing and committing in Gilead. What was our fault in Gilead? We was involved in what? Idolatry. Alright? Worshiping idol gods. Come on.
Then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land.
And will what?
And will heal their land.
And will heal their land. Christ is the bomb. If we only begin to apply what we just read here, this is how we get healed with that bomb, which is the word of God. Jeremiah 51. Everybody rocking with me?
Yep.
Jeremiah 51 and verse 4.
Book Jeremiah chapter 51 and verse 4.
Uh-huh.
Thus the slain shall fall in the land of the Chaldean, and they that are thrust through in her street.
And those that are thrust through in her street. So some, many of us die in the land of the Chaldeans, meaning the Africans. Come on.
For Israel had not been forsaken.
Because understand, even though there was no healing, there was no balm in the land of Gilead, or no physician to administer to us, God says, what was going to happen to Israel?
For Israel has not been forsaken.
Understand, Israel will not be forsaken. Come on.
Nor Judah of his God, of the Lord of hosts.
Not any of the 12 tribes will be forsaken. Come on.
Though their land was full with sin against the Holy One of Israel.
Even though we're in the midst of sin in the land of Gilead, God says, listen, not all of them will be forsaken. Even in the midst of our folly, the Lord still granted us what? Grace and mercy. In the midst of our sins. And whatever land we were scattered to. Everybody see that? All right? So Christ is going to save and heal our land. Christ is that bomb. He's going to forgive all of our sins if we only repent and turn back to him as his chosen people. Read on.
Verse 6. Flee out of the midst of Babylon.
God telling us to do what?
Flee out of the midst of Babylon.
At this time, he's talking about ancient Babylon. But now we're dealing with today's time. We got to make the Bible relevant to today. Today, this place is known as Babylon. Understand that thing. Read.
And deliver any man his soul. Be not cut off in her iniquity.
He's telling you, listen, be mindful. The same prophecy Jeremiah was giving him then. It's the same thing we're giving you all today through the spirit of our forefathers. Do not be cut off in her iniquities. What is her iniquities? Idolatry. Here in America. Read.
For this is the time of the Lord's vengeance.
For this is the time of the Lord's vengeance. Read.
He will render unto her a recompense.
He will render unto her a recompense. Hold that. Give me Revelation chapter 18 and verse 4. Revelation chapter 18 and verse 4 is saying the same exact thing.
The book of Revelation chapter 18 and verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people.
God says what?
Come out of her, my people.
Come out of her, my people. Read.
That ye be not partakers of her sins.
That you do not be partakers of her sins. Read.
And that ye receive not of her plague.
And that you receive none of her plague. Jump to verse 1.
Jeremiah chapter 18 and verse 1.
Revelation 18 and 1.
Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven,
mm-hmm.
having great power, and the earth was lightened with glory.
Come on.
And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the Great is falling.
Babylon the Great is falling. Babylon the Great is falling. This was written many years after Babylon the Great, after Babylon, ancient Babylon, was destroyed. So what is this talking about? Future Babylon. This is talking about this place that we presently live today. Give me Revelation 11 and verse 8. Coming back to Jeremiah. Revelation 11 and verse 8.
Book Revelation chapter 11 and verse 8.
Uh-huh.
And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city.
We are sick. We are being afflicted. We need that balm. We need Christ to come back and deliver us and redeem us and restore us. We lay, our bodies lay in the city. Among the streets. Come
which
on.
Spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt.
Revelation chapter 11 verse 8 one more time.
Revelation chapter 11 and verse 8. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city.
The great city is representing the United States of America. This is that great city. Which is what?
Which spiritually.
Stop. That's the key that is talking about future Babylon. It wasn't talking about literal Babylon. This is spiritual Babylon. Read.
It's called Sodom and Egypt.
And it's also called spiritual Sodom and spiritual Egypt. The same thing that we're reading about in Jeremiah chapter 51. Let's go back to it. Jeremiah 51. I want you to pick up verse 6 one more time.
Well, Jeremiah chapter 51 and verse 6. Flee out of the midst of Babylon.
God is talking about us in these days and time to flee out of spiritual Babylon the Great. Everybody follow. Come on.
And deliver any man his soul.
And make sure you deliver your soul by doing what? Keeping the commandments. Not getting involved in what this place here has to offer. Read.
Be not cut off in her iniquity.
Don't be cut off.
For this is the time of the Lord's vengeance.
Because this is the time that God is going to give to every man according to his or her works. Come on.
He will render unto her a recompense.
Mm-hmm.
Babylon had been a golden cup in the Lord's hand.
It's been a golden cup in the Lord's hand. Tantalizing. Something to be admired. People love and flock to America. Come on.
That made all the earth drunken. The nation have drunken of her wine. Therefore the nation are mad.
Therefore the nation are mad. Give me Revelation chapter 17 and verse 4. Therefore the nation are mad. It says, Babylon have been a golden cup in the hand of the Lord. All right? And that all the earth is drunken. And the nations, with an S, have drunken the wine. All right? Therefore the nations are mad. What are you talking about? Revelation 17 verse 4.
Revelation 17 verse 4.
Come on.
And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color.
This is talking about Babylon the Great, we'll be in right now. Come on.
And decked with gold and precious stone and pearl.
Uh-huh.
Having a golden cup in her hand, full of abomination and filthiness of her fornication.
So what it's going to and equating what we just read in Jeremiah 51 about the earth is drunken and all the nations are drunk of her wine, meaning all these other foreign countries that think America is such the great biggest thing on planet earth, they too have fell subject to the dang old wine that she had in her cup. Meaning they too partake in the folly that she was in. The lies, the deceit. They all partake in that. Come on.
Verse 5. And upon her forehead was a name written.
Mm-hmm.
Mystery. Hello. Babylon the Great. The mother of harlot and abomination of the earth.
So when you go back to Jeremiah chapter 51 and verse 7 one more time.
Jeremiah chapter 51 and verse 7.
Come on.
Babylon had been a golden cup in the Lord's hand.
America has been a golden cup in the Lord's hand. Come on.
That made all the earth drunken.
Every nation on the planet earth have drinking or take part of America's folly. Come on.
The nation have drunken of her wine.
Wine equates to lies. Come on.
Therefore, the nations are mad.
Therefore, they too are full of lies and they are mad. Because they fell subject to her lies as well. Just like how we did. Come on.
Babylon is suddenly fallen and destroyed.
Oh, so now you look around America, they're going to be destroyed piece by piece. Come on.
Howl for her. Take balm for her pain.
Take what?
Take balm for her pain.
If you really want America to be soon, take balm for her pain. Now, Jeremiah is mocking the destruction of Babylon. Since our people wasn't dang on giving no balm to be healed, and there was no physician there to heal them, and since you feel so bad for them being destroyed by the hands of God now, find your balm to heal them now. See if it's going to work for them. This is why we say God is a just God. When you do wrong against his people, you're going to receive the same affliction. You're not going to escape. Read.
If so, be she may be healed. We would have healed Babylon, but she is not healed. Forsake her, and let us go every one into his own country. For her judgment reaches unto heaven, and is lifted up even to the skies.
So now, when you read this, the nation's now finally waking up from the folly, and they're not shook the dust off from their dang old eyes and stuff, and realize, whoa, wait a minute, this stuff had us caught up. You almost caused us to get dang old burned up with you. Now all the nation is saying, let us forsake her. Let's not be a part of her no more, because she about to be destroyed. Let's separate ourselves from this dang old woman. That's the same thing that's going on right now. The same that we teach all the time when we teach it here in this body. Learn how to forsake certain people when they're trying to cause you to go into the school system.
But Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 4.
Come on.
That thou shalt take up this proverb against the king of Babylon.
Against the king of Babylon. Babylon, the king of Babylon today is going to the powers that be, the rulers of this nation. All right, that's them. That's the king of Babylon. Come on.
And say, how hath your oppressor ceased?
How hath you then go fell from your then go throne of glory? Come on.
The golden city ceased.
The golden city had ceased? What? Read.
The Lord had broken the staff of the wicked.
So now he explained that the Lord is the reason why you cease. The Lord had broken your staff. The staff goes into the dangle scepter. You know how every king have a dangle stick in his hand with like some kind of jewel or ruby in it? That's what it's going into. The Lord has broken your staff that you rule with. Read.
And the scepter of the wicked, of the rulers.
Uh-huh.
He who smut the people in wrath with a continual stroke.
He was doing this thing for so dang long. He got used to it. Come on.
He that ruled the nation in anger.
He ruled the nations in anger. Come on.
Is persecuted and none hinder it.
And nobody then gonna take stock and say, wait a minute, I don't think you need to be doing this. Come on.
The whole earth is at rest.
The whole earth now, because this thing was sitting and went down, once America goes down, the whole planet is gonna be at rest. The whole planet. Read.
And it's quiet.
And it's quiet, at peace.
They break forth into singing.
They break forth into singing?
Yea, the fir tree rejoiced at thee and the cedars of Lebanon, saying, since thou art laid down, no fowler has come up against us.
So now, it's going to get to the point that once this place goes down, everybody on earth going to be able to take a deep breath and dangle a sigh of relief. But as long as America's ruling, it's going to be turmoil and chaos throughout this whole freaking planet. Even the trees is going to rejoice when this place goes down. The trees going to say, thank you, God. We can finally breathe without all this toxin in the air from these dang old machines and stuff that they're creating. Sucking up all the oil and all the fire going on. They're going to begin and they're going to praise the Lord. But black people, I don't need to praise the Lord. I like the white man. I'm going to praise him. Keep doing what you're doing. Give me wisdom, Psalm 18 verse 7. We almost done. We almost done. Christ is the bomb. Understand that thing. So Christ was sent to heal our land. Christ is going to be sent to heal the brothers and the sisters, the 12 tribes of Israel. Christ is our physician. He is our healing ointment. He is our bomb. Anybody understand that? Wisdom of Solomon chapter 17, I mean, I'm sorry, 18 and verse 7. Wisdom of Solomon chapter 18 and verse 7.
But in the Apocrypha, Wisdom of Solomon chapter 18 and verse 7.
So once this city goes down, we just read that all the nations is going to be able to take a deep breath. The trees is going to rejoice. Israel is going to rejoice. Now, just in case somebody don't believe that that's right, I don't think that sounds like it's of God. Read this.
The book of Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 18 and verse 7.
Uh-huh.
So of thy people was accepted both the salvation of the righteous and destruction of the enemy.
So in order for you to say that, Lord, I want you to heal me, heal my people, heal our land, you first have to accept the salvation of the righteous and the destruction of the enemy. That's the stipulation. If you say anything contrary to that and you have a rebuttal, you will not receive the bomb. Not the B-A-L-M. You won't receive that bomb. But you will get a wrecking bomb. That ICBM, that bomb is what you're going to get. Because why? The stipulations is, in order for salvation to come, somebody has to be destroyed. You have to accept that. That comes with the healing ointment. If you don't want to be healed, then that's saying to God that you'd rather be in captivity and remain to be stricken more and more. You like your behind cut. So in order for you to get redeemed, you have to accept the destruction of your enemies. Give me Luke chapter 5, verse 30. Who needs healing? All right. Who needs healing? Does everybody on planet Earth need healing? Does everybody on planet Earth need the bomb, which is Christ? Mm-hmm. Look at these people around you. Not everybody on planet Earth need that dang old healing, are you?
The book says Luke chapter 5 and verse 30.
Come on.
But the scribes and Pharisees murmured against his disciples.
The scribes and Pharisees murmured against the disciples. Come on.
Saying, why do ye eat and drink with publicans and sinners?
So they questioned Christ. Come on.
And Jesus answering said unto them,
what he said?
They that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance.
So Christ came to heal those that are sick, those that need a physician. Who here by a show of hand needs a physician? We all need healing. Every last one of us, I can guarantee you, have some kind of ailment in our body. And that's talking on a carnal level. But on a spiritual level, we need to be healed spiritually. Our spirit is yearning for that ointment. It's yearning for that healing power. We need that thing desperately. So Christ is telling the scribes and Pharisees, listen, I ain't coming for the ones that's already saved in their mind or think that they ain't gonna need a physician. I came for the sinners, the one that acknowledge that we have sinned before the Father. Crying out to the Lord, keeping these commandments. That's who I came to heal. Those are the brothers and sisters that need that healing. Give me the book of Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Luke chapter 4 and verse 18.
The brother said, Luke chapter 4, verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because he had anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor.
God have given us that healing ointment to anoint the people, to preach the gospel unto them. Read.
He had sent me to heal the brokenhearted.
He has sent us to heal the brokenhearted.
To preach deliverance to the captive.
And preach deliverance to those that are in captivity. Every last one of us that's listening in here today and online, or whatever we're going to teach, understand, you are in captivity. Because how we know? This gospel being preached to you. And Christ said he was sent to do what? Preach deliverance unto who? The captives. So that means if he's talking to people that's already saved, this Bible is not true. It's not a real book. It will make no sense. So Christ is telling you, if you're reading this and you're hearing this, you, brother and sister, are in captivity. Come on.
And recovering of sight to the blind.
And if you don't believe that, because you're blind to the fact. Come on.
To set at liberty them that are bruised.
Instead of liberty, meaning give us space and opportunity to rehearse these righteous acts. That's what liberty goes into. A little space, a little wiggle room to begin to cry unto the Lord to come and redeem us. Read.
To preach the acceptable year of the Lord.
To preach the acceptable year of the Lord. What is the acceptable year of the Lord? Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 2. What is the acceptable year of the Lord?
The book Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 2. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all that mourn.
So the acceptable day of the Lord is the day of vengeance. That's the acceptable year of the Lord. When the Lord comes to wreak havoc on the inhabitants of this land to restore his people, Israel. That's the acceptable year of the Lord. Everybody see that? Give me Matthew chapter 15, verse 24. Who needs healing? The sinners, those that need a physician, those that are brokenhearted, those that need to be healed, those that are in captivity, those that are blind, those the brothers and sisters that need this healing ointment, this balm. Read that.
The book of St. Matthew chapter 15 and verse 24. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
So in case you didn't get it no other way else, and you didn't understand it in the first two precepts, we further explain who he's talking about that he needs to heal. He said what?
But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
That's who need the healing. He's only sent unto them, the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That's who needs the healing. Understand that thing. All right, from there, give me the book of Psalms, chapter 107. Psalms 107 and verse 20. So now we're going to establish who needs this balm, this healing ointment. The house of Israel. Those that are brokenhearted, those that are sick, wounded, blind, destroyed. Those are the ones that who God sent to be healed. So who is the healer? Read that.
The book of Psalm, chapter 107 and verse 20. He sent his word and healed them.
His word is sent to do what?
And heal them.
It's sent to heal us. So if you're looking for any kind of dang on ointment or remedy to heal you, spiritually, you're blind. You don't understand what we're talking about. We're sent to heal us spiritually so that we can have access into the kingdom is this word. That's what he sent to heal us with. Read it again.
The book of Psalm, chapter 7, 107, verse 20.
Come on.
He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction.
And delivered us from this destruction. Give me Revelation chapter 19, verse 12. His word was sent to heal us and to deliver us from destruction. Brothers and sisters, destruction is headed for America. It's headed for this whole planet. And this word is what's going to heal us and protect us from the things that's to come.
The book of Revelation chapter 19 and verse 12. His eyes were as a flame of fire,
mm-hmm.
and on his head were many crowns.
Uh-huh.
And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself.
Come on.
And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood.
This he was clothed in a vesture dipped in blood.
And his name.
And his name.
Is called.
Is called.
The Word of God.
So who is the healer? The Word of God. This dang old brother that sat on his horse. That had a name that no man knew. This is our healer. Wisdom of Solomon chapter 16 and verse 12. Christ is our healer. Understand this thing. Wisdom of Solomon chapter 16 and verse 12. Christ is our balm. Come on.
The book in the Apocrypha, the book Wisdom of Solomon chapter 16 and verse 12.
Listen up.
For it was neither herb nor mortifying plaster.
This is good. He said it was neither herb or mortifying plaster. Come on.
That restored them to health.
These things did not restore us to health.
But thy word.
But thy what?
Thy word.
Thy word. That's what's restoring us to health. Come on.
Oh Lord, which healeth all things.
Hey, I love this Bible. It tells you straight up. God's word is what heals all things. Who is the word? Christ. In the beginning was the word, and the word was what? Christ. God. Just get back. Get John. Go to John. Let's go to John real quick. John 1:1. Because you know I'll butcher it up. But it's that's telling you who the word is. Alright? John chapter 1 and verse 1. It wasn't mortifying plaster or herbs that healed us spiritually. It was the word of God. Spiritually.
The book of St. John, chapter 1 and verse 1.
Come on.
And the beginning was the Word.
The beginning was the Word.
And the Word was with God.
And the Word was with God.
And the Word was God.
And the Word was God. John 9, verse 14.
Verse 14. And the Word was made flesh.
Mm-hmm.
And dwelt among us.
And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us.
And we beheld his glory.
And we looked upon him.
The glory as of the only begotten of the Father.
The only begotten of the Father is who?
Christ.
Christ, read.
Full of grace and truth.
Full of grace and truth. So just in case you don't understand who the healer is or who the Word is, it's Christ. There's multiple scriptures we can go to that will prove this thing. But those are, they should be plain enough to suffice until you come into the understanding. From there, give me Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. So in order to be healed, we must have faith in Christ. We not established that we had imperfections in us. We were sick. We were destroyed as a people. We would continue to backslide. All right? And we was full of all kind of spiritual sickness. But God, the Heavenly Father, sent his Son to heal us with the Word. Because he is the balm. But in order for us to be healed, brothers and sisters, we have to then have faith in Christ. Read that.
The book of Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent.
Do what?
Repent.
Do what?
Repent.
Christ began to heal our land and began to heal us by teaching for us to do what?
Repent.
Read.
For the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
The harvest is then going to pass. Summer has come. You better make sure you're in the time of the harvest. Read.
Verse 18. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren,
mm-hmm.
Simon, called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea,
mm-hmm.
for they were fishers. And he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.
He said, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Jump down to verse 22.
Verse 22.
Uh-huh.
And they immediately left the ship and their father.
They made haste and delayed not to follow Christ. They had faith in Christ. That's the same stance that we got to take in this truth. Read.
And follow him.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus went about all Galilee.
So now, listen to what Christ started doing. Read.
Teaching in their synagogues.
He was teaching in their synagogues. This is all the land of the Jews. Read.
And preaching in the gospel of the kingdom.
And preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Come on.
And healing all manner of sickness.
Uh-oh.
And all manner of disease among the people.
And he was healing all manner of sicknesses and diseases among the people. In order for you to then go be healed, you got to follow Christ. You got to have faith in Christ. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1. A few more scriptures and we're done. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1.
The book of Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1.
Come on.
And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples,
uh-huh.
he gave them power against unclean spirits.
So now, if we want to be healed, brothers and sisters, we got to first follow Christ. And we got to also imitate and do the things that Christ did. However, we do not have the literal power that he gave his disciples, we'll be reading about here. But the power that God did bestow upon us, we do have that to this very present day. And it's the Word of God. We just explained, the Word of God is what? Heal us, not mortify and plaster us. These things is what God was doing. So therefore, what we're reading is how we heal the people today, just not with the literal power aspect. Read.
To cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease.
So he gave this power among his disciples. Come on.
Now the names of the 12 apostles.
Jump down to verse 5.
Verse 5.
Uh-huh.
These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them,
saying,
go not into the way of the Gentiles.
Wait a minute. Stop the press. All the presses. Christ anointed the 12 and told them, listen, this power that I bestowed upon you, don't give to the Negro Gentiles. Don't give it to the strangers. Read.
And into any city of the Samaritans.
In any city of the Samaritans. Read.
Enter ye not.
Enter ye not. Don't go to them. I'm going to deal with them. I'm sending another brother to go deal with the Samaritans. Read.
But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Come on.
And as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
When we go on the streets and these brothers teaching that, listen, y'all better repent because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's the power that God gave unto us to heal the people. Come on.
Heal the sick.
Heal the sick.
Cleanse the leper.
Cleanse the leper.
Raise the dead.
The spiritual that is dead and is true. Come on.
Cast out devils.
You got to cast out liars.
Freely ye have received, freely give.
So the gift that I give unto you all freely, you all got to freely give unto them as well. Our job is to heal our brothers and sisters the same way that God healed us with this word. Healing the sick, raising the dead, cleansing the lepers. This is all spiritual sickness that God said our people are afflicted with. But those brothers that teach this word, your job is to heal them now. We got powers, but we got to dangle, have faith in Christ and trust in the process. Understand this thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 8. In order to be healed, we must have faith in Christ and follow his example. What is his power?
The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 8. Charity never fails.
Charity never fails. Meaning love never fails. Come on.
But whether there be prophecies.
But whether there be prophecies.
They shall fail.
They will come to pass.
Whether there be tongues.
Whether there be tongues.
They shall cease.
The ability to speak in different languages. That will cease. He's talking about what? The 12 disciples. Come on.
Whether there be knowledge.
Whether you have understanding of this Bible.
It shall vanish away.
It should eventually vanish away. Read.
For we know in part.
For we know in part.
And we prophesy in part.
Meaning we understand this Bible in part.
But when that which is perfect is come.
But that which is perfect is come, meaning Christ.
Then that which is in part shall be done away.
Whatever we don't quite understand right now, Christ is going to give us the understanding of it later on. This is why we read earlier when it says, he said, I'm going to plead with them face to face. Then we're going to get the understanding of what things we did not understand presently today. Christ is going to clear things up at that point in time. Everybody understand that? But the point I'm going to draw out of that is whether it be the powers, those things too shall cease. We're not going to have spiritual power, mean literal power, like he gave his disciples. Meaning, when they went into the Feast of Pentecost and they started speaking in unknown tongues right there in the spot, we don't have the ability to do that right now. That was given to them, boom, just like that. We don't have that. Those powers is gone. You ain't gonna learn something just in a dang a matter of seconds. Nuh-uh. That's why he said, listen, you gotta get you some brothers that speak in an unknown language and bring them and have them interpret to the one that can't understand you. That's how we work together now. But that little power that was bestowed upon the 12 tribe and the 12 disciples, we do not have that now because the Bible says those things will cease. So if anybody come and tell you, oh, I'm smarter about you, they speaking in tongues, they're lying. Every day, anybody in Christian church that does that, they are liars. And I dare you to tell me I'm lying. Prove to me I'm lying with the word of God. I guarantee you, I can prove you all day long with the word of God, you are a dang old liar. Because God said those things will cease. And then even what you do right now, it's not even speaking in tongues. It's gibberish. It's called glossolalia. Look it up.
Babble.
Babble. That's exactly what it is. Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 30. In order to be healed, we must have faith in Christ. Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 33. You're almost done.
20:33. Mm-hmm. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 20, and verse 33.
Uh-huh.
As I live, saith the Lord God, mm-hmm. surely with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out will I rule over you.
God is not going to play with us. Read.
And I will bring you out from the people and will gather you out of the country wherein you are scattered.
Meaning with the place that we're scattered now, all throughout this earth, and we're not in our homeland, God's going to redeem us out of all these lands. Come on.
With a mighty hand.
Uh-huh.
And with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out.
Read.
And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there I will plead with you face to face.
When we did not understand in part, he's going to give it to us then. Read.
Like as I pleaded with your father in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so will I plead with you, said the Lord God.
Read.
And I will cause you to pass under the rod.
The rod represents correction. Read.
And I will bring you into the bond of the covenant.
And you will adhere to the covenant. Read.
And I will purge out from among you the rebels.
And those that refuse to dangle, keep the commandments or the covenant, they will be purged out. Another word for purged out means killed. Read.
And them that transgress against me, I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn. And they shall not enter into the land of Israel. And ye shall know that I am the Lord.
And you will understand. And that day, if you don't understand now, and that day, it's going to be a tag on lose switch for you. Because you had the opportunity to learn him on this side. But you want to learn him on that side? When he said, listen, I will not play with you. Meaning you will be put to death. So you better learn him now. Because if he has to deal with you, you will be cut off. Understand that thing. All right? From there, give me Psalms 147. So now as we close up, brothers and sisters, this is God healing us. This is the conclusion. God is healing us. This is the bomb. Psalms 47, verse 2.
The book of Psalms, chapter 147, and verse 2.
All right.
The Lord doth build up Jerusalem.
The Lord does build up the Jerusalem. Come on.
He gathered together the outcasts of Israel.
And he will gather the outcasts of Israel. Come on.
He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wound.
And he healed the broken in heart and he binds up their wound. God is healing us. From there, Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 4. God is our healer. He's healing us. Alright?
The book of Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 4. And though even thyself shall discontinue from thy heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thy enemy in the land which thou knowest not.
Uh-huh. Jump down to verse 14.
Verse 14. Heal me, O Lord.
So then when we living in the land of our captivity and we discontinue from our heritage, we have to ask the Lord to heal us. Like how Jeremiah said, listen, it was prophesied to us, you too, Jeremiah, you forget. You forget all these things that I'm telling you right now. But in that day, I'm going to show you how to come back. Ask the Lord to heal you. That's what Jeremiah said here, verse 14.
Heal me, O Lord.
Heal me, O Lord.
I shall be healed.
And I shall be healed. Trust in the process. Come on.
Save me.
Save me, O Lord.
And I shall be saved.
And I will be saved. Come on.
Thou art my praise.
For you are my praise. Exodus chapter 15 and verse 26. Exodus chapter 15 and verse 26. Ask the Lord to heal you, you shall be saved. Ask the Lord to save you, and you will be saved.
The book of Exodus, chapter 15, and verse 26. And said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God,
if we listen to the Lord our God,
and will do that which is right in his sight,
uh-huh.
and will give ear to his commandment, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee.
If we do what God tells us to do, all these things such as COVID-19, monkeypox, all these new diseases that's going to be coming out pretty soon, God said, listen, if you just hearken unto me, I will not put these diseases among you. You will be protected and you will be healed. Finish that up.
Which I have brought upon the Egyptian, for I am the Lord that healeth thee.
God is the Lord that healeth us. Understand the last scripture, Isaiah 53, verse 1. So as we close up, brothers, this is the conclusion of the whole matter. All right? Christ is our balm. He's the one that's going to heal the nation of Israel. He's our healer. But in order for us to be healed, we must have faith in Christ. Come on.
Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 1. Who had believed our report?
Who here believed what we just reported? Those of you that's listening online and listening right now, who is going to believe the lesson that was brought out? Read.
And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?
And who is the arm of the Lord revealed? He's showing you his strength and his power through his prophets. Read.
For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant.
He shall grow up before him as a tender plant. Who is he making reference to? Our Lord and Savior, our healer, the balm. Read.
And as a root out of a dry ground, he had no form nor comeliness.
This is talking about Christ didn't have no form of comeliness, meaning he was not the best looking brother on the planet. Read.
Verse 2. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground, he had no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire.
When we see him, there should be no beauty that we should desire him, because our people have lustful eyes. So therefore, Christ got to come down like that. Read.
He is despised and rejected of men.
He is despised and rejected of men. Read.
A man of sorrow.
He's a man of sorrow.
And acquainted with grief.
And acquainted with grief. We too have that same thing in common with Christ. Read.
And we hid, as it were, our face from him.
And we hid our face from him. We don't want to have nothing to do with him. Come on.
He was despised. And we esteem him not.
And he was despised, and we did not support him. We did not heal him. When Christ was being afflicted, nobody healed him. Nobody gave him a balm. No physician came to soothe his wounds. Nobody did that. Read.
Surely he had borne our grief and carried our sorrow.
But yet he hath carried our grief and our sorrow. Read.
Yet we did esteem him stricken.
But yet we did esteem him stricken. Come on.
Smitten of God and afflicted.
We watched him be smitten and we watched him be afflicted. Come on.
But he was wounded for our transgression.
But yet Christ was wounded for our transgression.
He was bruised for our iniquity.
And he was bruised for our transgression. Our iniquities equate to sin. The things that we've done, Christ didn't commit one sin, but he was bruised for our iniquity. Come on.
The chastisement of our peace was upon him.
The chastisement of our peace was upon him, meaning the balm for the affliction that we went through was upon him. Read.
And with his stripes.
And by his stripes.
We are healed.
We are healed. So understand, brothers and sisters, when we talk about Christ, Christ is the balm. Understand that thing. So with that, brothers and sisters, I'm going to say shalom. Most High in Christ bless. Hope y'all learn some of the ways.